Well, if you were faced with a life and death situation, how would you react? Our next guests were strangers when fate brought them together, but they've since formed a very special bond after one heroically saved the other's life. Neil Clugston and Cassandra Scott, welcome to Studio 10, guys. Cassandra, let's start with you. Tell us what happened the day that you almost died.
Well, it was the 12th of December, 2012, which is a little uncanny, but not that I believe in that. But the day that the world was supposed to end, according to the main calendar. So that morning, I didn't wake up and think today's a good day to die. Nonetheless, I was living in Coogee at the time and went down to the beach as I normally did for a morning swim, and took a dive under the wave, and that was all I remember.
Wow.
That was it.
You hit a sandbank or something?
Not really sure what happened on the day. I do have epilepsy, and there is a theory that I may have had a seizure in the ocean, but no one actually knows.
And how did Neil then come into the picture?
Well, I was minding my own business, swimming in Coogee. I was living in Coogee at the same time, and I was about 20 or 30 metres out, and I saw Cassandra floating face down in the water.
Oh, wow.
And she had goggles on. Right. And I thought, well, maybe she's looking at fish, but I watched her for quite a while and nobody looks at fish that long without taking a breath, so I swam over and I did probably what is the first step of CPR, which is touch and talk. So I screamed, "Are you okay?" And she didn't respond. I thought, that's rather snobbish of her.
What is Coogee?
But that gave me the license actually to grab her and flip her over. And it's then that I realised that she was actually gone. She was grey and her lips were purple and no signs of life at all.
So you're still in the water at this stage?
Still in the water, floating. About 30 metres out, and she's floating on her back now. And I realised that now there's a matter of minutes to get her to the shore and get some CPR going on her, because otherwise there would be no hope. I had no idea how long she'd been in that state. Yep.
So what do? You dragged her to shore?
Flipped her over and dragged her to shore, and I did the drowning, not waving, to the lifeguards as I went and pulled her into the shore. We got rolled in the water a few times and hit the sand at the bottom, and I still got incredible vivid memories of both of us, but particularly Cassandra, because no muscle tension. So the body is just liquid in the water. God. It's phenomenal.
Cassandra, can I just ask you, what's it like to owe somebody your life? Do you feel...
There is no greater debt that you can have to owe someone your life. And I owe not only Neil my life, but I owe another three complete strangers my life. And they gave me the gift of life because they all had the courage to go and see whether a complete stranger was okay. Yeah. And I have a bond of love with those people. And since I was brought back to life with Neil and the help of a lifeguard called Luke and an off-duty doctor called Matthew and a Belgian tourist called Olivia.
How wonderful.
Then those four men have become like brothers.
It really does show the importance of CPR, doesn't it? And we're going to do a bit of a demo today to show you at home how it is done. Jess is with Professor Paul Middleton, who is the founder of Take Heart Australia. Jess?
Thank you, Sarah. Well, we've just heard, Professor, how important it is to know CPR, how it can save lives. I'm also joined by Nick, who's a paramedic, who you just do such incredible things.
Thank you.
You're going to talk us through what we need to do for CPR, and
sure.
Nick, you're going to demonstrate.
Absolutely.
Absolutely. So, because the heart has stopped and there's no blood flow going to the brain or anywhere else, what we need to do is to immediately get in there, making sure that you're not going to come to any harm as well.
Mm-hmm.
So the first thing to do is to check for danger.
Mm-hmm.
Check for danger, and then what you're going to then do is to see if they are alert.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and so you're checking for response and then sending for help, because nobody can do this by themselves.
Mm-hmm.
Yelling for help. The next thing to do is to open up their airway. That means to tilt the head back and to check to see if they're breathing, because now the definition of a cardiac arrest when your heart stopped is just that you are unresponsive and you're not breathing normally. And Nick checks for 10 seconds. And if that works, if there's no signs of any breathing, he's not responsive, then he immediately starts doing CPR. And what you can see is that he's doing chest compressions to a third of the depth of the chest, 100
beats
a minute.
So that's pretty hard then, isn't it?
It's really hard work.
Yeah, and it's quite a strong pressure.
Absolutely. You have to have your elbows locked. You have to have your shoulders above your wrists, because if you don't, you use your upper body. If you don't do that, you get really tired really quickly. And it may be 10, 20 minutes before somebody else comes to help. You don't know.
And what about how many compressions? Because sometimes people get confused about having to do it for a certain amount of time, then taking a break, then going back to doing it.
Well, what we do now, we encourage people not to do the breathing, because you don't need to do mouth-to-mouth, and that used to make people not keen to do it. So now, if you tilt the head back so the airway is open, just keep doing compressions, and you do it at 100 to 120 a minute, 2 a second, which is Staying Alive by the Bee Gees, basically. So you can sing that in your head, sing Staying Alive, and carry on going. And the important thing is that you carry on going at that rate, at that depth, and that you don't stop. Because what that's doing is pushing blood through to the brain and keeping that patient alive, because every minute that goes past without CPR, 10% of people die. So at 10 minutes, everybody's dead. But if you do this, that reduces by about three times. So absolutely essential to do this.
And you've got a special event coming up?
We have got a day on Monday the 30th of November. That's Take Heart Australia Day. And actually what we're doing is going for the Guinness World Record in the number of people trained in CPR across multiple venues. So Allianz Stadium is the big one, and we have a lot of coverage there. A lot of people, we hope thousands of adults and children being trained. And then we have other events across Australia, a lot of them in New South Wales, in regional New South Wales, Dubbo, Bathurst, and then some being organised in Queensland, Tasmania.
So. How wonderful, Professor. Thanks so much for coming in. Nick, you can have a breather now. Thank you for all that you do. And so we've really seen how simple it can be to do CPR. You can learn more about those CPR training events at the Take Heart Australia website. Check it out, as you never know when you might be needed to save a life, like we've just heard Cassandra's story. Sarah?
It's so important. Thank you.